Hi, everyone. My name is Deb Wallace, and I'm the Executive Director of Knowledge and Library Services. And we're just delighted to have you join the last Books at Baker for this term, because we're going to be taking a little bit of a break over the summer. So we couldn't have asked for a better faculty member to join us than Felix Oberholzer-Gee, who's going to be talking about his book, Better, Simpler Strategy today. I'm going to talk a little bit about the session first so that you know how it's going to roll out. Felix is going to talk a bit about the book first, and then we'll open it up with questions from our participants. So all you have to do is type a question in the chat and we'll get to it, as many as we can within the hour. But I wanted to just give a very brief introduction of Felix. Most people will know Felix because, first of all, he's like one of our most celebrated faculty members here at HBS, also the former a senior associate dean for the MBA program. So anybody going through the MBA program at that time would know Felix well as the amount of teaching that he does in our executive education program, both in the general management program. He's also the faculty chair of our leadership program for China and the Driving Digital Strategy program. So Felix has done it all across the school, but he's probably best known for his After Hours podcast, which has turned into be just a fabulous, fabulous way for Felix to talk with his co-host, to talk about his ideas. So here's the book. It's out, Yahoo. Felix, welcome. I'll turn it over to you and let's hear about these core concepts and then we'll open it up for questions. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much for the nice introduction, Deb. It's extra special to be here. Baker Library is such a cornerstone of HBS, and it's truly a privilege to have a chance to talk about the book here in the context of Books at Baker. What I thought I would do is I would give you a little bit of behind the scenes kind of look, share some of the insights, mostly thinking about what I learned from working on this project for quite some time, as you can imagine. It takes a little while to write a book. Some of my main lessons that I took away, some of the stories that stuck with me as I did the research. The first message that I would like you to remember and I would like to send this afternoon is really a sense of optimism. As I did the research for the book, and as I looked into company stories, and as I looked at company performance, I walked away thinking, it is true for almost every organization, every business, that better performance is within reach. This is not something for a special few companies that can operate, I'd say, Apple-like levels. This is true what's probably right for your organization, probably right for many companies that you're familiar with. If, in fact, we think about value creation the right way, companies can be much more successful. And you probably know, if you know me, I'm an optimistic person. But in this case, this has actually nothing to do with my personal optimism. This is just a reflection of what you learn once you start looking at the data. So I wanted to share one set of data with you, which is literally the chart that I started out with. I looked at the S&P 500 firms and I wanted to know, how well do they do over long periods of time? And when you look at the chart, the first thing that struck me, that perhaps strikes you, is, oh my God, this is an amazing variation. There's so many brand names, there's so many really mature companies, and you wonder, how much runway do they have? How much better can they actually do? And then what you see is, in this group of really established companies, we have so many stellar performance. And this is not a US phenomenon. If you look across different countries, I'm showing you Brazil, China, India, South Korea, it always looks the same. For almost every company in every corner of the world, it is true that better performance is within reach. And you can slice and dice the data every which way you want. Here, I'm showing you a chart that lists companies by sector that they're in, by industry that they're in. And the length of the bars is basically, again, the variation in performance. And it's the same message. You can do far better. Exceptional performance is not for a select few. Exceptional performance is possible for many, many companies. I give you one example. If you're exactly average in your industry, say we rank 100 companies from 1 to 100, you're exactly 50th. And I move you up just 10 ranks, not making you a superstar firm. I'm just improving your performance a little bit by 10 ranks. Your return on invested capital will increase by 20%. Isn't that amazing? So optimism is perhaps the most common notion that I wanted to develop in the book. And then, of course, the question is, well, optimism is nice, but how do you actually do it? And so I thought I would see innumerable, complicated, highly sophisticated strategies. And what I got instead by looking at all these successful firms was actually something quite different. I saw many of these firms do something really simple most of the time. And that is they increase the willingness to pay of their customers, the most the customer would ever pay, or they decrease the willingness to sell of employees and suppliers. Willingness to sell is the least amount of compensation that you need to pay in order to keep someone in your business or in order to keep a supplier interested in working with your firm. That's it. There's nothing else. You know how sometimes we have this notion, oh, you have to be super senior to think about strategy. Wrinkles, white hair, all the rest of it. No, nothing, nonsense. It is very simple. Increases in willingness to pay, decreases in willingness to sell. There's nothing else. Three stories. The first one takes us to South Africa. This is a South African insurance company called Discovery. And if you have health insurance with Discovery, you get access in supermarkets to special places where they sell healthy foods. And you get the health foods at amazing discounts, sometimes half off, sometimes up to 70% off. And so of course, it's a little surprising, why would an insurance company partner with supermarkets to offer healthy foods? Well, because if we have better eating habits, then of course we live healthier lives, insurance costs go down. That's the directive. But much more important here and in many other examples is an indirect effect. Who is particularly interested in access to healthy foods? Health conscious consumers. And there are low costs to insure. So those are two questions I would always like to ask you. First, you see an idea, you see a project, you see an initiative. Does it increase willingness to pay? Does it decrease willingness to sell? If the answer is no, it's not worth doing. Second, what's the selection effect that you introduce by pursuing a particular initiative? Who are the consumers who are most interested in what you just did? Who's the talent that wants to join an organization that just launched a project of some particular type? It's both increases in value and the selection effect that then creates superior performance. I'll take you to the US next. The Gap, probably many of you know, a fashion retailer. They're struggling with churn. Many companies leaving the organization just after, you know, not such a long period of time. You have to retrain, which tends to be expensive, which leads to many mistakes. How do you create better jobs? Jobs that people really want to hold on to. And it will be natural for The Gap to think about better compensation, perhaps to think about sales training. How do we get managers to take better care of the employees? And they do none of that. They do something that retailers typically don't think about because it doesn't concern them so much. If you work in retail in the United States, you know your schedule about a week in advance. And the number of hours that you get fluctuates wildly from week to week. Differences in income of 40% are not unusual. And so The Gap sets out to create more predictable schedules and more predictable income. How do they do this? Super simple. They allow people to trade shifts. Oh, my child has fallen ill. I cannot show up at work today. Let me offer my shift to someone else. It's the end of the month. You know, picking up an extra hour, a few extra hours might be really good to do. Oh, I'll pick up. Employees share shifts 10,000 of times each month. What's the response? Well, same store sales go up. Labor productivity goes up. But perhaps most important, churn goes down. Employees report being not as stressed. And in particular, parents report that they sleep better. Value created all around. Last story. In the Far East, Raksul is a Japanese printing company, and they connect businesses. It's a B2B business. They connect businesses with print shops. Japan has an almost insane number of print shops, 30,000 at the last count. And so businesses go to Raksul's website and they find a print shop where they would like to get their printing done. And then Raksul thinks, well, actually, because we have so many different print shops, it would be nice if we steered the businesses to the print shops that have the right equipment to print exactly what you want. What happens? Oh, quality goes up, higher willingness to pay, cost and willingness to sell go down because printing on the right equipment, so much easier to do. Next, they're thinking, what if we steered businesses to the printers who have the right equipment, but not much work at this point in time? The machines are idle all the time. Oh my God, costs fall even further. And then at a third stage, they start hiring Toyota engineers who know everything there is to know about continuous improvement. They send them to the print shops and they drive down costs further. What's the end result? Amazing printing quality and high willingness to pay. Super low willingness to sell and costs because we're printing on the right equipment that would have sat idle in a way that is consistent with modern production techniques. Notice what's common across all of these stories. We just created a ton of value. We increased willingness to pay in each one of those, and we decreased willingness to sell at one and the same time. So five things I learned. The first thing, perhaps a little counterintuitive, strategy is simple. You don't have to have a lot of experience. You have to have a lot of imagination. But in the end, it's just about increases in willingness to pay, decreases in willingness to sell. For all of these firms, and for many others that I describe in the book, it's true that they pursue a surprisingly small number of projects. We all have so much work. We all have so much going on. But I would ask you to carefully consider for every one of your projects, for every one of your initiatives, does it really increase willingness to pay? Does it really decrease willingness to sell? If you're not sure, it's not worth doing. As we saw in the insurance example, the best companies always compete on selection. They get to serve the very customers for whom they created extra value. And they attract the very talent that finds the culture of the organization particularly interesting. Food, turns out, is a complement to insurance. Did you know? Oh, and it turns out a simple app and a smartphone is a complement to better jobs. The most successful companies almost always compete with the help of complements, and they shift profit pools back and forth between their core products and the complements that they have developed. And then finally, and you may have noticed, all of these companies have dual advantages. Remember Stuck in the Middle, how we taught a whole generation of strategists, you have to choose either your high quality or your low cost. If you're trying to do both at the same time, if you're trying to have an advantage in willingness to pay and an advantage in willingness to sell, you're stuck in the middle. Nothing good will come of it. These companies and many more, no more stuck in the middle. In fact, I'd encourage you, it is possible. In fact, it is desirable for you to aspire to dual advantages. Let me stop here so that we have time for questions.
Thanks. Thank you, Felix. I hope you could see on the side in the chat is so much fun because you've got GMPers from all around the world who are chiming in, offering their congratulations and support for your work. And I think there's some sort of, is it a sports game going on right now?
Yes, so I heard.
Yeah, something, I don't know. So I've got a couple of questions just to get things going, but this is not a shy and retiring crowd. So please put your questions in the chat and we'll get to as many of them as we can. You know, I'd like to do a word count on your bullet points because you're a person who understands bullet points. I don't think there was one that had more than five in it. So one of the things that I'm struck with is, you know, living just on the edge of Walden Pond, as we do in Boston, where Thoreau had his famous time talking about back to nature. It's, anyway, if you go walk around Walden Pond, there's a visitor center there with, of course, a gift shop. And everything plastered on, coffee mugs and t-shirts and stickers, et cetera, is simply simplify. And so when I think of Thoreau, that's always what, how do we simply simplify? And you have brought that to the forefront with your book. But why is it so difficult to be simple, to simplify? Why is that so difficult for us?
So I think when you look at the strategies that companies try to pursue, you see many layers, right? There's a marketing strategy, there's an innovation strategy, there's a global strategy. And each one of these layers actually responds to something that's really important. So the moment the economy globalizes, you want to have a global strategy. The moment it's not always easy to hire the right talent, you want to have a talent strategy. And so we're getting into organizations that in the end are immensely complex because we're good at picking up on trends, keep picking up on changes. Where it ends up hurting us is that it becomes very difficult to bundle all of these activities. Right. When I visit companies, I'm always impressed by just how much is going on. You know, last I checked, you didn't have infinite budgets. Last I checked, you didn't have quite the people you wanted to work for you. And yet you're doing so many things. Deb, if I think about the Baker Library, the same is true. You're doing so many things with quite limited resources. Yeah. But much of the effect is lost if we don't have a direction that A, customers can experience and that we can communicate with inside the organization. If I see an 86-page PowerPoint deck that describes your strategy, I know your strategy is not real because you have no chance of explaining the 86 pages to anyone, probably not even your board of directors. And so simplicity has a special place in strategic decision-making, both because we need to bundle to really create value for customers in a particular way, to create value for employees in a particular way. If we sprinkle value creation across 1,000 dimensions, no one will notice the difference. And the second reason why simplicity is so important is because we need to communicate. If you know the strategy, but no one else in your organization knows, nothing good will happen. And so simplicity is really at the core, and I wanted it to place at the core of the book.
Felix, I could go on with questions all day because I love this book, I love this work, but I am seeing that, and because I should point out, we did this project earlier with Felix when he and Francis Fry were teaching a course, and many, like some of the questions that are coming in, people said, could you just do something really simple for us that would boil down these concepts? And so we created this, which is called the Pamphlet Project. And it's where Felix and Francis just boiled everything down really to the clearest terms in like a little 15-page booklet, very small. And because people are asking, can you explain a little bit more what you mean by the willingness to pay and willingness to sell? These are concepts that I think some people are not quite picking up on. So if you could
underscore. Absolutely. So in my experience, willingness to pay is very intuitive. In fact, I would be very surprised if I could tell you anything new about willingness to pay. it's the maximum that you would ever pay for a product or a service. You know, when you look at something and you think, oh my God, this would be really nice to have, but then it's just a little too expensive. The price is a little above willingness to pay. Willingness to pay is just that maximum. Now, what's interesting, willingness to sell, in a sense, is exactly the same for employees and suppliers, but we have much less intuition. Often I encourage people to think about the following scenario. Say you have a friend who works at some other company and you want the friend to join your organization. And you're thinking about what is the minimum compensation that I need to offer her to make her move? So that when she sees the offer letter, she goes, oh, it's that organization, it's that job. And the salary is not really all that fantastic, but just about good enough for me to move. That is her willingness to sell. Now, that does not mean that that's what we pay her. Willingness to sell and actual compensation are different, just like willingness to pay and prices are different. But it tells us something about the attraction of the job. If the job is her dream job, you don't have to offer all that much money and she will still come. Yeah. Every time you improve work, you improve, you create better jobs, willingness to sell will fall. If the job is very risky because it's a dangerous occupation, I want a premium for doing something dangerous and willingness to sell will go up. I want to be compensated for a job that is not so attractive. And so as always, willingness to sell and willingness to pay, those are data. This is not my imagination. It's driven by the data. When do people change jobs? When do people buy products? And so you can measure them and you can build your strategy around these two concepts. Yeah.
You know, I was thinking about the willingness to pay. And because I thought, you know, living in the United States, retail is king in many places. And, you know, everybody's looking for the best sale and the Black Friday shopping spree and the tax-free weekend. And so I thought, well, nobody's willing to pay anymore for a product. And then I recently bought an Apple computer. And I thought, and this is another one of the examples that you put in the book.
Yes.
People are willing to pay a higher price. I could have gotten a much cheaper a PC, and I didn't. I decided to buy
Apple. Yes. And it's a great example, Deb. And so I think what it teaches us is consumer decisions are really guided by the difference between willingness to pay and price, right? If the Dell computer had the Apple price tag, you wouldn't have thought about it for a very long time. But of course, Dell, smart, they know they have lower willingness to pay. As a result, they have a lower price. And now if you compare these two differences, all of a sudden, it's no longer so clear. Are you better off with the Apple? Are you better off with the Dell? One implication is that you don't have to be the quality leader in your industry in order to be successful. The Hyundai group of cars didn't get to 10% market share in the United States by building the very best car. They found a very appealing combination of moderate willingness to pay and really attractive prices. So as you think about competition, always think when I compete for customers, I want to create what I call customer delight. A big difference between willingness to pay and price. If I compete for talent, I want to create a big difference between how much I pay and people's willingness to sell. Every time I drive down willingness to sell, I become a more attractive employer.
There's it's interesting here what people are talking about, how simple strategy. And I think at some point you say something about that the strategy is straightforward in theory, but it's incredibly difficult in practice. And we're having a number of questions coming in saying, okay, so I have a simple theory. How simple is it to implement that? I have a simple strategy. How easy is it to implement that simple?
Yes. So the challenge is not in figuring out what your value proposition should be. The challenge is to then have novel ideas how to drive up willingness to pay or how to lower willingness to sell. Think of strategic decision making as a challenge in creativity. as a challenge in where do new ideas come from? Because the framework itself, what we need to do, that is, you know, we have 15 minutes with one another and everybody knows, oh, we only need to increase willingness to pay, decrease willingness to sell, done. But now the question is, how on earth do I actually do it? And so think about all the kinds of things that go into moments when you feel really creative. When do you feel at your best? When do you feel like, oh my God, that setting, we had so many ideas. We really dreamed big. That's what your strategy process should feel like. Mm-hmm. I often ask people, like, what's a strategy meeting like? How often do people laugh? And almost everyone's like, oh, we never laugh in strategy meetings. And then I said, well, when you do something really creative, like, how often do people laugh? Oh, we laugh all the time because, you know, I have crazy ideas and some of them work and some of them don't. And that's the juxtaposition. So you should think of strategic decision-making as first and foremost as a question of creativity, mm-hmm. as a question of having new ideas that you can then implement. Yeah. And that is challenging. That's not an easy to see something that is truly novel is not an easy thing to do. The last third of the book or so is all about implementation. And it basically gives a little help, at least I hope, to have you think about where new ideas come from.
Yeah. There's a another person has asked, is there a scenario where trading WTP with WTS brings advantage to the strategy? So like, are there trade-offs between the two ends of the value stick?
Yes. So let me say something about willingness to pay and willingness to sell first. I mean, this goes back to this notion of being stuck in the middle. You have to choose. And I think the intuition that was a right intuition is that often in manufacturing, you cannot have both, right? Why? Well, if you're in manufacturing, better products take better inputs and better inputs are typically more expensive. Mm-hmm. So you really have to choose. Do I have an increase in willingness to pay? Do I play the premium game? Or do I have a cost advantage, in which case I don't have the best inputs? The mistake I think that we made is to then extrapolate this insight onto all the businesses. Mm-hmm. And I think in services, it's never true. Well, how do you get really great service? We get really great service from really engaged employees. How do you get your employees to be really engaged? By creating really attractive work conditions, by driving down willingness to sell. And so in services, I think if you have jobs that are not great, I will be so surprised if you were able to produce a superior customer experience. Yeah. I think almost always higher productivity, like in the Gap example, goes hand in hand with creating better jobs. And as a result, you don't look at any of the recipes. I often joke when you go to the bookstore in the airport, pre-pandemic, of course, all of these books basically give you recipes how to be successful.
Yeah, yeah.
Be really global, be really big, do really this, do really that. Mm-hmm. And when I took these recipes, and I have some in the book, and I took them to the data, I always find the recipes work for some companies. Actually, that, you know, the authors of these books, they're really smart. They see some examples that work. But then I find so many companies where they don't work. And so rather than following recipes, you have to choose between willingness to pay and willingness to sell, or you don't have to choose between willingness to pay and willingness to sell. Just think about these two concepts in the context of your business. Can I imagine a world in which I couple better jobs with a better customer experience? If so, there's no trade-off. If I can't imagine that world, then probably you have to choose high willingness to pay or low cost.
And of course, a question on everybody's mind is, we are living in a very complex environment right now with everything going on. Starting, well, today, big day for us in Massachusetts is the end of the emergency, a state of emergency. Also, California has lifted all of its controls around COVID restrictions today. So we're coming into this whole new world, creating a new normal. How are strategies going to change, keep up with this changing environment?
I think having a simple framework that captures the essence of value creation and financial success is particularly important in moments like these, because there's so many unknowns, right? We don't quite know, like, what are the longer productivity implications of keeping workers at home? We get some early data. I think we have some pretty good data from IT businesses that report that we have a steep decline in productivity. But we have other businesses where actually productivity seems to hold up quite well when people work at home. And so again, rather than thinking, oh, can I guess what the world would look like? Can I follow best practice when it comes to creating hybrid work environments? Just think about your own situation. How much do people appreciate not having to commute? How much do people appreciate being able to work at home? For some of your staff, it's going to be a dream come true. For some of your staff, it's going to be the most horrible thing ever. And so willingness to sell will fluctuate depending on the kinds of work situations that people are in. What's the effect on productivity? If productivity goes up, willingness to sell will decline. If productivity declines, willingness to sell will move in the other direction. And so you just want to think for every idea, for every technology, for everything that changes in this world, filter it through willingness to pay, filter it through willingness to sell, and try your best to guess how they will move. And one reason why this is so important is because we get swept up in trends all the time. Go back roughly 6-7 years or so, you will find that 80% of North American companies had working groups who were thinking about blockchain, because blockchain was the big thing and everybody thought, oh my God, blockchain is going to change everything. Today, we have about a little more than 10% of companies think that blockchain will actually make a difference. Why? Because everybody was so excited about the technology, but once they started looking into it, they found, oh, it doesn't change willingness to pay. It doesn't change willingness to sell. It's probably not worth doing. And so you can save yourself a lot of trouble. You can take a lot of shortcuts just by using this as a filter. Remember, the very best companies don't have thousands of initiatives. Think of a really big and sprawling company like Google. 2/3 of Google's profitability comes from that original idea of how to do search in a better way. Can you believe that? It's still basically what makes Google today. And they have started dozens and dozens and dozens of businesses. And frankly, in many cases, don't really have that much to show for it. Why? Because they don't create value.
Are you seeing with the companies you're working with and following a change in their approach to strategy development and execution during the pandemic and or as we're coming out of it? Are people thinking differently about strategy?
I think some of the most interesting questions have to do with, have we learned things about willingness to pay and willingness to sell that we never really knew, right? So on the commuting front, yeah, that's not news. We knew that people don't like to commute. And as a result, it was an advantage to be in a place that is easy to reach. Lots of companies knew that. On that front, how much did we learn? Probably not that much. Say, take e-commerce. I was always reluctant to buy groceries online because I just love the idea of picking apples myself. Now it turns out if I have them delivered by e-commerce companies, actually they're doing a pretty good job at picking apples also. And so I've learned something about my willingness to pay, and that is now a strategic opening. So behavior will not snap back to pre-COVID states because we figured out a thing or two about willingness to pay and willingness to sell. But that's how you want to think about it. Everywhere where there's no reason to believe that willingness to pay changed dramatically, there's no reason to believe that willingness to sell changed dramatically. My prediction is we will snap back to the way things were. You know, we now realize the quite dramatic costs of tight supply chains, but there was a reason why supply chains were so tight to begin with. And I bet we will go back to a state, once we're in steady state, we'll go back to tight supply chains before we know it. Why? Because it's just the cost economics. Yeah. It's just that willingness to sell dictates that having lots of excess inventory, of having multiple manufacturing locations when in fact you have economies of scale, those strategies don't really pay off.
Right. Another person has asked about what's easier to copy by a competitor. So thinking about your competitors, not just your customers and your suppliers,
partners,
what's easier to copy by a competitor, willingness to pay or willingness to sell?
So generally speaking, when you look at the most successful companies, I see as many companies that have a decisive advantage in willingness to pay, something that is not easy to copy, as I see companies that have a decisive advantage in willingness to sell. So you can't say easily it's one or the other that is much more promising. But what I love about the question is, of course, it puts a little nuance on what we need to do. We need to not only increase willingness to pay and decrease willingness to sell, we need to do it in a manner that is differentiated from the competition. And so I'll test every one of my ideas essentially three filters. The first one, does it create value in the first place? The second one, what's the selection effect? And the third one, how easy is it to copy? And the moment it's easy to copy, the moment it's easy to imitate, I'm a little less enthusiastic about these ideas. Of course, we understand strategic trade-offs. Mm-hmm. Doing some things amazingly well with resources that you don't spend elsewhere.
Right.
As my colleague Francis Fry would say, you have to be bad in order to be good. If that's how you build your strategy, imitation becomes much less of a threat. Because I look at you, I see what you do. It's not that special, but I don't want to make these same trade-offs. And as a result, we increase differences across business as opposed to we speed up the rate at which our good ideas get imitated.
There's another question. Is there a difference between B2B and B2C in applying your strategy?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Super interesting.
It must have been in your GMP class.
So I would say on the willingness to pay side, there is probably a difference. So when it comes to B2C businesses, I would love for you to think about willingness to pay as this wide open concept. You know, so many things go into it. Yes, it's the functionality of the products, it's the attribute, but it's also the social prestige, it's the brand association. Look at how people feel when they buy an Apple product. The moment they hold it in their hands, they feel a little different. So it's lots and lots of things. In B2B transactions, willingness to pay still depends on some interesting factors, like what's the relationship that we have. In particular, in Asia and in other economies, the relationship is super important. But generally speaking, there's a little more rationality. What's my willingness to pay for a machine that reduces costs by $200 million? Well, $200 million. Not that much more, not that much less. So that's a difference in willingness to pay. In willingness to sell, remember, one of the key ideas is if you can lower the cost of your supplier, some of that benefit stays on your P&L. And so the idea is you, just like you have customer intimacy, you really need to know your suppliers well. You need to understand their cost structure and then work with them to take out costs. That always requires quite a bit of trust, because as a supplier, I always feel, well, you pressed me on price for so many years. When you come to me and now you say, oh, you know, maybe we should look over your cost structure, I fear the worst. I fear you're going to figure out how I make my margin and then you're going to pay me less. And so that's a tricky thing in B2B relationships, where the most successful companies that do this really well, Nike is a good example. They built an entire training center in Sri Lanka to teach Asian suppliers continuous improvement. And the way they did this was really built around notions of trust, because the suppliers knew, we go to the center, then our costs will decline. And of course, Nike knows that our cost declines. Is Nike going to be fair in sharing that value with us? And so Nike over time built a reputation for that kind of fairness. And it's a special issue. It's a special challenge in B2B relationships that we don't have so much in B2C businesses.
Yeah. Well, I would be remiss with this beautiful background of Baker Library that I'm standing in front of, and with one of the world's largest collections of business manuscripts dating to the 14th century. I have a great passion for business history. And I've noticed that in a number of the stories, the Michelin story in particular, you go back to where the whole Michelin rating comes from, and how does that have anything to do with selling tires? So tell us how, in setting these strategies, when we're looking at our current environment, how often, or what's your advice on also looking back at where the company has come from?
Looking back is so important. Understanding where you come from, how you created value over time, what your brand stands for. It's times that, of course, we often think, oh, things were way simple back then. But there were so many, I think, opening moments where things that we take for granted just didn't exist. And as a result, as a historian, you often see things that are quite difficult to see in the current context. Let me give you one example. When I teach people about compliments, I usually say, there's almost nothing that's more important than what are the compliments and what are the prices of the compliments for your products. And they look at me a little bewildered and they say, well, how can, we never really talk about compliments. How can they be so important? And I give them the example of the early automobile history. Think of your willingness to pay for a car in a context where there's no roads, there's no gas stations, there's no repair shops, there's no maps, there's not any of the things that makes car valuable. And so you go back in history and you look at instances where compliments didn't exist. And of course, under that circumstance, for Michelin, the tire company, to get people to drive, it was sheer torture. They lobbied the government so heavily to install road signs. Because guess what? You were out of town. There was no map. You had no idea where you were. You had no idea where you could go. The roads were terrible. It was a miserable experience to drive. And so if you want to see like a life illustration of just how many compliments it takes to make a product really valuable, I think business history is really just wonderful.
To go. Welcome to Baker Library, and we can research almost any business for you. There's another question about HR. So in terms of HR, does pay for performance work to create more long-term value?
So I'll say two things about compensation and the structure of compensation. Often when I speak with companies that really face sort of the brunt of the war on talent, and I ask executives, what's the best way to get the people you need, to get the talent you need? Invariably, among the top one or two criteria is better compensation. We just have to pay more. And what I like to point out is, of course, if you pay more, you get a greater pool of talent. But two things are also true. You don't create any value. That's just shifting value from shareholders to employees. There's many good reasons to pay generously, to pay living wages plus, but it's not value creation. It's just shifting from one pocket to another. The second, when we think about these selection effects, so say I have an organization that is best in class in training. There's a hospital group that I write about in the book in Florida that just has like an amazing training philosophy. What's the benefit of doing that? Well, you get better trained people, of course, but also everyone who's really interested in training, they're dying to get one of these jobs. Why? Because I know I get this really fabulous training. What happens if I offer money? What's the selection effect? Oh, there's no selection effect. Why? Well, last I checked, everybody likes money. So if you try to attract with more generous compensation, not only do you not create value, but you're also not getting a particular slice of the talent. Every time you drive down willingness to sell, you do it in a very specific way. You provide a lot of psychological safety. You let, like Google does, engineers on Friday can work on whatever project they want. Mm-hmm. and so on, and so on, and so on. The moment you use culture, the moment you drive down willingness to sell, you get a selection effect. You create actual value. Now, can you combine this with performance pay? Absolutely. The usual caveats apply. If you can't precisely measure the performance you truly care about, performance pay is dangerous because people will do exactly what they're paid for and not what you care about. So think about your measurement issue and think about how best to couple value creation with smart ways of compensating people. Compensation is not value creating.
You know, as I was reading the book, I had a little notepad, and I was writing down these statements that rang true to me. Things like think value, not profit, and profit will follow. What is straightforward in theory, which we just talked about, is often difficult in practice. Strategy is conceptually simple because it serves a single purpose: creating value. Value creation comes before value capture. Have we just complicated the language of business? Is it time to, I think you talk about going back to the basics, and is it not just in strategy, but even talking about our business? Is there a lesson, another lesson for us to learn from not just simpler strategy, but simpler conversations, simpler approaches, just simplifying?
I think it's definitely true. I feel across this book project, I think I see it on the podcast, people crave real conversations, not complicated scheming, lots of jargon. Let's just say why we show up for work every day. And I think for most of us, the idea of having a job where I get to show up every day and I get to create more value for customers, more value for suppliers, more value for the people you work with, that's a dream job. I think the conversation that we're having about purpose at this moment ties very closely to this notion of value creation. And one reminder, I think, that is important to keep in mind, there's purpose at the level of the organization. Mm-hmm. And that is, I think, what many of the boards and many of the corporate leaders are thinking about. But there's also purpose at the level of the individual, which is willingness to sell. If I have a really meaningful job, if I have a chapter on passion, as you know, if I'm passionate about my job, that drives down willingness to sell. And the two are not the same. You see it in professions like nurses. Nurses would generally say, the purpose of the hospital, fantastic. I buy it every day. This is why I went into nursing to begin with. But the reality of my job, my day to day, do I really feel like I get to create value? Not so much. I'm running like a headless chicken from bed to bed, trying to do a million things. It doesn't really feel the purpose of my job is what I hoped for. And I think we've gotten better at talking about the big purpose for the entire organization, but we have a lot of work to do creating the kind of work, creating the kinds of jobs that lower willingness to sell, where I as an individual can say, I love what the company is trying to do, and I love my everyday job. Yeah. I love being there Monday morning.
Well, there's a question that has come in that was one that I had on my sheet too, then, is how do we measure value? Often we do think about measuring value from the perspective of the financial returns. One of the ending stories about Tommy Hilfiger and the accessible clothing, that's measuring value in a whole other way. What sorts of range of value measures, and how do we decide what value measures make sense for us to follow?
Yeah. So the first thing to say is you don't get to decide. What value is in the eyes of the customers, of the employees, and of the suppliers. That's not your decision. Okay. And so the total value that an organization creates is the difference between willingness to pay and willingness to sell. And then it gets split three ways. Some of it goes to customers, mm-hmm. some of it goes to employees and suppliers, and some of it goes to shareholders. And I think the really interesting question that we're debating right now, which is the very final chapter, is should we somehow rethink that division? Should we somehow, the way we share value today, where we say we give as much to the customers as we have to in order to be competitive, we give as much as we have to employees in order to attract talent to the organization, and then the entire residual goes to shareholders. I think there's a life and interesting question whether that way of dividing up value is exactly right, or whether we need to rethink market economies and capitalism in ways that is imaginative about how value creation works. What's important to me is to say that that conversation about how to divide value, super important. But actually, that's only an interesting question if we become really good at creating value in the first place. If we don't create much, think about it. The chart that I showed that I began with today, a third of S&P companies don't have returns that cover their cost of capital. There's no value to be shared. And so, yes, how to share value, super, super important, but let's be in the business of creating, first and foremost, as much value as we can. And then let's be smart and fair about how we share it.
Well, there's a related question from an emergency room physician. And his question is, how best to reclaim and control this value? It's well explained, but basically saying, I think that this value is being skimmed off and taken away. And so how do we best reclaim this value?
So one, of course, is that we have companies that now compete for investments in ways that are unusual. So go back to the moment when Whole Foods went public. They announced in their prospectus that 10% of their profits would go to causes that they would choose. So there's no redistribution between shareholders and the owners of Whole Foods, because you knew what you got into when you bought the stock in the first place. There's now obviously a huge conversation around ESG investing, capital being allocated to firms that think creatively about allocation of value to different causes, allocation of value to different groups. And all of that is progress, but none of that is a substitute for value creation, right? In fact, we always, you see it in economies that don't grow very quickly. The moment we are in an economy that doesn't grow, where wages don't rise, we get so much conflict around redistribution of income. The moment the economy grows really quickly and the rising tide lifts not all, but many of the boats, conversations about sharing value become much easier. And so that's a second sense in which I think, yes, let's talk about how to divide up value. And let's talk about whether there are better ways than the way we have traditionally done it. But everything is predicated on this notion that a lot of value gets created in the first place. And the book is really a book about value creation first and foremost. And then the sharing is an interesting secondary problem to think about.
Yeah. We're getting very close. I can't believe like an hour goes so
time flies.
I know. But Felix, I want to give you a chance. There are lots of other questions and we'll package these together and send them to you, because it'd probably be interesting for you to see what else people are asking. But do you have any final words for us, or a point you want to leave us all with?
One of the things that I thought about while writing the book is this idea that being in management, running a company, being responsible for others, to my thinking, it's such a noble profession. Think about it. Like you get to go to work and basically, you know, we don't always say it that way, but basically your job is figuring out how you create more value for employees, for customers, for suppliers. And then this contrast with service in the US now say about 50% of the people believe that capitalism does more harm than good. And it just struck me as such an interesting tension between what I think about as the core of business, really being in the business of creating value for others. Even if you're the most selfish person running a business, your best chance of creating a lot of wealth is to think about others all the time. That, in some sense, is the beauty of business. But I think the reality is that so many people don't see this, don't see it in business. And if I could pinpoint to one reason, I think it's often to think about value capture, to think about your own income, think about how you get to get additional profits before you think about value creation. And so in my wildest dreams, what is my hope for the book? Well, my hope for the book is in part that people go back to something that feels like an older principle, an older orientation. I personally love reading faculty who taught at the Harvard Business School 50 years ago, 40 years ago, and where in many of their writings, you see this orientation towards, we're just in the business of creating more value. And then, yeah, we can have an interesting conversation about how it gets divided, but that's not really why we're doing it. And if the book can make a contribution to this effort, I think we're all so much better off. Nothing worse can happen to us than forgetting about value creation in the first place.
Well, you've given us a lot to think about, but in simple terms, with a straightforward framework, with some common language. Again, one of the things that I love about in here is that you're helping us focus and make some choices and giving us permission to say, no, don't tell my staff. I hope none of my staff are watching this. They're going to say, remember what Felix said is, no, you're doing too much. But my guess is that in this complex world, it's going to take a little while for this new normal to settle in. But I hope you've given us a lot to think about and hopefully to embrace this notion of simple. So let me just simply say thank you.
You're very welcome. It was a pleasure to be here. I greatly enjoyed my time and appreciate all the questions and all the engagement.
There's also a number of other people we need to thank because, you know, these sessions they may seem magical, but they never are. And we have Matt Ridley from our media services helping us out today, and our marketing communications people, Ashley and Hensley, who help us we're talking about the importance of social media, of getting the word out and having conversations take place. And then I have two members of my team who have just done the lion's share of this work, Dina Gerdman and Mariah Tumbleson-Shaw, who make it all happen. So just so you know, we did record this session, so it will be available on the Baker Library website. We'll plaster it everywhere we can. So you have the opportunity to come back and listen to it again and hear how simple this really all is. It takes us about 10 days to get the transcript done and the editing of the video up, but we'll send you an email to all the participants so that you can get back to it. And Mariah has been madly putting links up in the chat for you to get to Felix's work and the Books at Baker page. As I said earlier, this is our last one of the season. We are going to take a break over the summer, but then that gives you lots of time to go back to the other sessions, both the live sessions and the studio sessions that we have done, so that you can learn more from our incredible faculty and take away some pearls of wisdom that you can implement in your own organizations. So thank you again, Felix, for joining us. I hope you saw all around that we had the world with us, from the Middle East to Europe to Asia. So one of the beauties of going online is that we can bring in this global audience. But we do look forward to being back on campus in the fall and doing some of these sessions also face to face, so that we can really enjoy each other's company. So all the best, stay well, and thank you again for joining us.